Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we are discussing about P-wave abnormalities in ECG. We have already discussed how P-wave is formed. Today we will see the abnormalities in P-wave, especially atrial fibrillation. So we will see what is P-wave now. This is SA node in the heart. This is the atrium, right atrium, left atrium. From SA node, electrical activities go to the AV node. From there, it will go to the ventricle. Okay. So, SA node activation produces a P wave. Okay. We'll see what is P wave. This is P wave. It's a dome shaped P wave. And you can see the length and height of the P wave. The length is maximum 2.5 to 3 squares. Height is also maximum 2.5 small squares. So, the if you want to remember, it is very easy. The length is 2.5 divisions, small divisions. Height is 2.5 small divisions. This is a normal P wave. When the P wave is originated from the SA node, every P wave in the ECG complex, in the rhythm strip, will be monomorphic, same morphology. And the height of the P wave will be 2.5 division, and width of the P wave should be 2.5 divisions. Okay. Now we'll see what are the abnormalities seen in the size and width of the P wave. Okay. So first of all, we'll see the height. If the height of the P wave increases more than 2.5 divisions, it's a peaked P wave. We call it as P pulmonale. P pulmonale is a feature of right atrial enlargement. P pulmonale is a feature of right atrial enlargement. This is classically seen in COPD with right atrial or right ventricular enlargement. We call it as core pulmonale. The same thing can be can also happen in acute pulmonary embolism. So core pulmonale can be seen in COPD patients, ILD patients, chronic lung disease patients, or acutely in pulmonary embolism also. But there are different other conditions, cardiac abnormalities, where the right atrial enlargement, there also you can see a very tall peaked P wave. This is called as P pulmonale. You can remember it is peaked P wave, seen in, called as P pulmonale, classically seen in core pulmonale. So peaked P wave. So P pulmonale. So it's mostly related to pulmonary diseases like COPD, ILD, any acute lesions like pulmonary embolism. Now, if the P waves are wide and notch in that, the width is more than 2.5 divisions, we can call it as wide P wave, but there is a notch, it's a M-shaped P wave, you can call it as P mitral. P mitral is classically seen in left atrial enlargement. This is classically seen in mitral stenosis or sometimes mitral regurgitation. So a mitral valve disease produces a wide P wave, that is wide and notched P wave like a M pattern. This is called as P mitral. So the morphology, we are told to normal morphologies, height is 2.5 divisions, width is 2.5 divisions. It is originated from the SA node going to AV node. And if the height increases more than 2.5 divisions, we can call it as core P pulmonale. This is classically seen in core pulmonale. And a wide notched M-shaped P wave is called as P mitral. This is classically seen in mitral stenosis or mitral regurgitation. Whatever it is, a tall P wave is seen in right atrial enlargement, wide notched P wave is seen in left atrial enlargement. So that is about similar morphological changes. Like P pulmonale means all the leads, you get same change. The same notched P wave seen in all leads, you can call it as P mitral. A tall P wave in all leads, you can call it as P pulmonale. But remember, P wave should be observed in either lead 2 or V1. Lead 2, classically, we take the lead 2 as the rhythm strip. You can see in the lower part of the ECG, you get a rhythm strip. There you can see the P wave properly. That's why we are taking lead 2 as rhythm strip. But whereas in V1, the morphology of PVA will be slightly altered. So there it will be biphasic. So that we are not discussing here. For easy understanding purpose, we are not going to that area. We are only taking the rhythm strips in lead 2. That's what rhythm strip you can see in most of the ECGs. It is taken in lead 2. So a tall P wave is P pulmonary, wide notched P wave is P mitral. Now, if we see that another important problem. So this is our right atrium, left atrium. Normal conduction starts from the SA node to AV node. So you get a normal P wave, dome shaped normal P wave. But sometimes this conduction can abnormally originate from some other part of the atria. So you call it as an extra beat, or it can be atrial extra systole. So suppose this is originating from here. So from here it is going. A single beat is coming like that in a rhythm strip, you can call it as an ectopic, atrial ectopic or atrial extrasystole. So the morphology of the P wave will be slightly different from a normal P wave. That's only because it is originating from another focus. So the morphology is different and it is only occurring very occasionally. Then in a rhythm strip, you may see only one or two. But remember, in a patient who is having some more focus, that is sending signals to the main pathway, and one is originated from the actual SA node, another was originated from here, and another was from here, and another one was originated from here. So the morphology will be varying. So if you are taking a rhythm strip, suppose you are getting this is like this, and this will be towards this side, slightly deviated to this side. So that is a third one, and another one will be like little sharp. So it will be like this. If multiple morphologies are coming, then there is a problem there. We'll see what it is. And remember, if one ectopic is originated from here, from the junction, and if it is going back, sometimes you can see the P wave may be inverted. But whatever it is, if you are continuously getting abnormal morphology P wave, more than 3 in a rhythm strip, you can call it as multifocal rhythm, or you can call it as wandering pacemaker. The pacemaker is wandering. So P wave morphology is abnormal from the original one, but PR interval, QRS complex, everything occurs. So that is called as wandering pacemaker. But if it is very fast, if it is more than 100, that irregular P wave with QRS complex, irregular means only in the morphology it is irregular, then you can call it as multifocal atrial tachycardia, MAT. So multifocal atrial tachycardia means large number of abnormal P waves are seen in the same rhythm strip. Maybe more than 3 or 4 you can see in the same rhythm strip, and heart rate is more. When the heart rate is more, you can call it as multifocal atrial tachycardia. If the heart rate is normal, you can call it as wandering pacemaker. If the heart rate is more, first of all, you have to see whether the patient is having hypoxemia. Hypoxemia due to any cause like COPD, ILD, that is a common cause for multifocal atrial tachycardia. That should be treated with oxygen. If the patient is having hypoxemia with this tachycardia, we have to treat with oxygen. If you want to control the rate, again, diltiazem, verapamil, all drugs are there. Beta blockers may be avoided in a case of COPD or asthma, something like that. So multifocal atrial tachycardia means abnormal P waves coming in a rhythm strip more than 3 or 4, you can call it as multifocal atrial tachycardia. So see, look at the morphology of P wave. All P waves in the rhythm strip should have same morphology. If one is abnormal, you can call it as atrial ectopic. If multiple P waves are altered morphology, you can call it as multifocal rhythm. If that multifocal rhythm is tachycardia, you can call it as multifocal atrial tachycardia. Commonest cause is hypoxemia. So that we have learned. Now another important problem in atrial abnormality. So we have seen multifocal atrial rhythm here. Now Another important problem is, this is your heart, the ventricle. So now what happens is, you know that from SA node, there is an electricity going to the AV node. From there, conduction occurs to the ventricle. So one electricity started from the SA node, that will be carried to the ventricle also. So the same electricity will be propagating throughout the heart. But in atrial fibrillation, there are multiple foci in the atrium. They all try to send electrical stimulus to the conduction system. So here atrium, it is beating in a rate of 600 beats per minute. So atrium is contracting in a rate of 600 beats per minute. Normally it is 70 or 80. Now it is 10 times 600 beats per minute. What happens if the atrium beats in 600 minutes and all the 600 go to the ventricle? Ventricle also fibrillates. So now atrium is fibrillating. If the all 600 come to the ventricle, that also fibrillate like 600 beats per minute. So there is no proper filling or there is no proper pumping. It's only fibrillating. So what happens is, patient will collapse because of hypotension. But God has given some checking mechanism here. All the 600 abnormal beats will not be conducted to the ventricle. From 600 conductions, it will block something here and it will conduct only 140 to 200, something like that. So heart rate is very high, but it comes in irregular manner. So we'll see what is atrial fibrillation. We'll see the ECG. Now we can see first the wave pattern. So there is a wavy baseline. That means large number of fibrillating waves are seen in the baseline. They all are P wave, but a normal morphology P wave you never see. It's only wavy baseline. And now one ventricular complex come. Now again wavy baseline, another ventricular complex come. Again wavy baseline, another ventricular complex. Another complex. Now another complex. So the baseline is wavy, that is because atrium it contracts in a rate around 600, and that 600, all 600 are not crossing to the ventricle. Only some 140 to 160 beats are crossing. So the ventricular rate will be somewhere around 140 to 200 or 220, like that. But atrial rate we cannot calculate. It is very high, more than 600. So the baseline will be wavy baseline, irregular QRS complex. That is very, 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 very important in atrial fibrillation. So irregular QRS complex is occurring. There is wavy baseline. Sometimes you cannot see the baseline at all. It will be maybe sometimes flat. Because of chronic atrial fibrillation, you don't see wavy baseline. But the QRS complex is irregular. So in an ECG, if you are seeing irregular QRS complex, and the QRS complex are narrow, that means less than 3 small squares, then that is definitely atrial fibrillation. So what you are seeing in atrial fibrillation is, normally in atrial fibrillation, heart rate is very high, more than 140 to 200, and the baseline of the ECG, all these things we are seeing in the rhythm strip, not in the other part of the ECG. The baseline of the ECG is wavy, it is fibrillating waves. Then QRS complex come in between, they don't have any proper alignment, so they are completely irregular. So irregular QRS complex. Whenever that QRS complex occurs, we get a pulse. So irregular pulse is a classical clinical finding of an atrial fibrillation. So now you can see atrial fibrillation is wavy baseline. So this is wavy baseline. You don't see any P wave. Then QRS complex are very fast and they are irregular. The space between QRS complex is irregular. So some part it is narrow, some part it is wide, but we cannot predict what time it will come. Okay, so irregular QRS complex, the space between the RR interval, you can see it will be varying. So that is atrial fibrillation. Now in emergency room, why we are worried about atrial fibrillation? We'll see why we are worried about atrial fibrillation. So you know that this is your atrium, this is your ventricle. Atrium, when the diastole, atrium or the AV valves will open, the blood from the atrium may flow to the ventricle. At the end of the diastole, the atrium contracts, that is atrial booster kick. The remaining blood will go to the ventricle. If the atrium fibrillates like this, some amount of blood may go to the ventricle, but the contraction of the atrium will never occur. So the amount of blood which is coming from the atrium to ventricle is reduced. It will ultimately lead to reduced blood pumping from the left ventricle, and this will be aggravated by the tachycardia. When there is tachycardia, the left ventricle will not get time to relax. During relaxation, the blood will come and accumulate in the left ventricle, and during systole, it will pump out the blood. So here what happens is, atrium is fibrillating like this, it does not contract. So the amount of blood coming to the ventricle is already reduced, and ventricle pumping is very fast, so it will not fill properly. So the ejection will come down, the amount of ejection will come down, total ejection, not during each ejection, the amount of blood which is coming out from the ventricle is coming down, and ultimately patient may collapse. So that is a problem in atrial fibrillation. Second problem is, atrium is not contracting properly, it is beating around 600 beats per minute, so only fibrillating. So what happens is, here some clots can occur. So some blood clots can occur that may come to the ventricle. From the ventricle, it will go to the systemic circulation. So these are the most important side effect of atrial fibrillation. Fast ventricular rate will produce hemodynamic compromise in the patient. Second one is, there will be blood clots in the left atrium or right atrium because of fibrillation. That may go to the left ventricle. From the left ventricle, it will go to the systemic circulation, and it may go to the brain. It can produce stroke also. So these are the two important side effects of atrial fibrillation. So we in emergency room, we have to tackle only two things. You control the rate, not the rhythm. Rhythm controlling is not the job of a ER physician. That is a job of a cardiologist. He can do it by electrophysiological study or some other maneuvers he can control. Some drugs has got the ability to control, like amiodarone can also sometimes control the rhythm. So whatever it is, we'll control rate and we'll avoid the blood coagulation problem here. So atrial fibrillation means, we already told, there is large number of QRS complexes, irregular, that means heart rate is very high, and wavy baseline of the ECG. Now what is our aim is, in emergency room, control the rate. So control the rate means, from here SNO to AV node conduction is there. From all these abnormal electrical areas, there will be a lot of electrical activity. What we can do is, we can block here. The SNO to AV node conduction occurs here, that area we can block. It is very, very important to block this area and control the rate. That is a major thing we should do in emergency room. So in that, if the patient is abnormal, we have to always go for electrical DC shock. That we'll discuss in a separate class. If the patient is abnormal, we cannot try all these drugs. So there you can go for a electrical DC cardioversion. But if the patient is stable, we can try with the drugs. So what are the drugs which can control the rate? The most important drug is beta blocker and calcium channel blocker, and you can also use digoxin. So three important drugs: beta blockers like metoprolol or any other beta blocker. You normally use metoprolol in emergency room. So metoprolol is a ideal drug to control the rate in emergency room. Metoprolol, calcium channel blockers like diltiazem or verapamil, digoxin. You know that beta blocker and calcium channel blocker cannot be used in cardiac failure, or somebody is having a left ventricular failure with atrial fibrillation, beta blocker and calcium channel blockers are not indicated, or they are relatively contraindicated. There only you have to use digoxin. Digoxin is a drug which can improve the cardiac pumping. So it can be used there, then it also controls the rate. So digoxin is the drug should be used in atrial fibrillation with heart failure. Amiodarone also can be helpful, but they are not first line drugs. Amiodarone also can be used. So if a patient comes with rapid heart rate which is irregular, you are suspecting atrial fibrillation, you give, if there is no contraindication, you give metoprolol 5 mg. Then you can see the wavy baseline will remain same, heart rate has come down, but still it is irregular. So heart rate may come down to less than 100, but it will be still irregular. That irregularity should be treated in cath lab with different types of drugs or electrophysiological procedure that we are not discussing here. In emergency room, you have to only control the rate rather than concentrating on the rhythm. You have to control the rate. We already told why we are controlling the rate, because a rapid heart rate can reduce the cardiac pumping. So diastolic phase is shortened, so the blood accumulated in the ventricle is reduced, so that reduces the cardiac pumping. Patient go to like hemodynamic abnormalities. So our aim is to control the rate with either beta blocker, calcium channel blocker or digoxin, and some patient may respond to amiodarone also. So that is the treatment we should use for controlling the rate. And if the patient is in shock or some hemodynamic instability, we have to go for DC shock or DC cardioversion. Another important problem, we already discussed that there are a lot of clots can form in the left atrium, that can go to the left ventricle. From there it go to the systemic circulation. Patient can develop stroke. So here you have to give drugs like heparin, low molecular weight heparin, then continue the patient on warfarin, as a vitamin K antagonist, or non-vitamin K drugs like they also can be given, but we will not be discussing the details of the drugs here. But whatever it is, we have to control the clot formation in the left atrium. That can be done with heparin, low molecular weight heparin, or warfarin, or alternative drugs. So these are the two important problems in atrial fibrillation. So we have discussed what are the abnormalities in P wave you can observe in ECG. You have to see the rhythm strip in the lower part of the ECG, then see what abnormalities are there in the ECG, whether it is a single complex or multiple complex or totally irregular. Sometimes you can see sawtooth appearance of the P wave, then more regular QRS comes. This is called as atrial flutter. It's a more refined form of atrial fibrillation. But in emergency room, we will not be acting on this rhythm because it's already controlled rate. So in emergency room, we no need to worry about atrial flutter. We are worrying about mainly atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular rate or multifocal atrial tachycardia. These are two important rhythms we should learn, and we should try to control the rate in emergency room. Thank you.